Let's go to foreign policy. This is your sweet spot. And one of the first things you did once you were elected to be a U.S. senator was organize a letter that 46 of your colleagues signed, and it was a letter to the Ayatollahs, warning them in the midst of Barack Obama's negotiations on the Iran deal, that whatever deal they entered into with Barack Obama, because it wasn't a treaty and didn't have the strength of force of legislation in the United States Congress, could be undone by whoever Barack Obama's successor was. That was exactly what happened. Donald Trump pulled out of the Iran deal. And I wonder, how would you grade Donald Trump on his interactions with Iran to date?
So I'll just say that, you know, that letter we posted to the Ayatollahs generated a lot of controversy. I don't really see why it was controversial. I mean, it was simple statement of constitutional fact. All those senators, I wanted to make sure that the Ayatollahs understood exactly what our system of government required.
Do you think they maybe did understand that? Were just happy to make the deal with the United States? Or do you think you really educated them?
I think we brought it to their attention, given the controversy it generated. If you want to have a lasting, binding agreement with the United States, you don't make simple executive agreements. You
right.
require a treaty that gets a vote in the United States Senate. And as we said in that letter, it could be upended by a single stroke of a pen by any future president. And that turned out to be the case, as the president rightly did about a year ago. And right now, I think things are moving in the right direction in Iran. Look, we just announced that we're going to go to zero oil exports for Iran. That is going to take their economy from where it is today at recession levels to, I suspect, to depression levels in the near future.
So your hope is that by instituting economic sanctions with Iran, even though the United States has pulled out of the Iran deal, that continued pressure from the United States will prevent Iran from continuing to try to develop a nuclear, fissile material or nuclear warheads?
Well, that's part of it, but it's not just the nuclear deal. I mean, part of the fundamental problem of the nuclear deal is it didn't address all of Iran's other outlaw behavior, like supporting terrorism against the United States and our allies, or arming rebel organizations throughout the Middle East, or its abuse of its own people. Mm-hmm. And as they face more economic pressure, as they face more military and political pressure throughout the Middle East, that puts them in the defensive position, as opposed to being on the offense, which is what they were for most of the Obama administration.
How does positioning the strike group and carrier in waters outside of Iran help that position?
And we're sending the clear message to Iran that we will brook no kind of attack, either by their own forces or by proxy forces against the United States or against our interests and allies in the region.
Could we win a war with Iran?
Yes.
That didn't take you a second.
Two strikes, the first strike and the last strike.
What are the conditions or the circumstances that would justify going to war with Iran?
Well, if Iran struck out militarily against the United States or against our allies in the region, then I would certainly expect a devastating response against Iran.
As somebody who fought in two fronts in the Middle East, both in Iraq and in Afghanistan, do you think it would be a good idea to go to war with Iran?
No, I don't advocate military action against Iran. I'm simply delivering the message that if Iran were to attack the United States, it would be a grave miscalculation on their part, and there would be a furious response. Now, we don't want to govern Iran. We don't want to rule 80 million Iranians. We want 80 million Iranians to be able to govern themselves and do so in peace and security with their neighbors and to taking account our interests in the Middle East.